What's going on, everyone? Hope you're doing well. It's a Monday, so I'm recording this on a Friday. Very rainy here. Hopefully Monday's weather is better. So we are going to pick up right where we left off with the winter hibiscus, part three. Do part four today. So hopefully we had that good class discussion about what happened, and hopefully it was said that she didn't do too well on this driving test. And now it's a little awkward. Her and the instructor are going back early. And I mean, by the end of this, the reading today, things are going to change drastically. I don't want to spoil anything, but I'm hoping you enjoy this story. I hope you can identify with it a little bit. I know I can, you know, just being unsure of yourself, things like that. And I mean, obviously she failed this test, right? Things did not go well. The pressure that she's going to feel with her parents. So let's do it. Hope you like it. 58 is where we ended, right at the top. Swallowing hard, she managed to drive the rest of the way back. In the distance, she could see the big M archway outside the McDonald's restaurant. And as she approached, she noticed David standing on the opposite curb, hands on his hips, watching their approach. With gratitude, she noticed that he had somehow managed to stake out two parking spaces in a row so that she could have plenty of space to swerve into place. She breathed a deep sigh of relief when the car was safely parked. Only after she turned off the ignition did she dare look the instructor in the face. How did I do, sir? She asked him, hating the quiver in her own voice. You'll get your results in the mail next week. All right, right off the bat, I mean, if anybody could pause here, anybody has any predictions? That's not good. Like, if you get your license, they tell you immediately. Like, that's a big thing. You can drive yourself home for the first time, and you don't need anybody in the car. You don't have to wait a couple weeks for your license. They take care of it right then. So he doesn't come out and say that she failed, but if she knows the process, she knows she failed. He said in that bored monotone again, as if he had parroted the same sentence countless times. Then he must have seen the anxious, pleading look on Sang's face, for he seemed to soften somewhat. You stopped when you didn't need to. You had the right of way at that first intersection, he said. Then at the second intersection, when you should have stopped at the stop sign, you went right through it. He shrugged. Too bad, he mumbled. Then he was out of the car, clipboard and all, and strolling down the curb to the next car. It all happened so quickly. Sang felt limp, so she'd failed. She felt the burning shame sting her cheeks. She'd never failed a test before, not even when she had first arrived in school and not understood a word the teacher had said. Had she ever failed a test? Tests. Always tests. There were so many tests in the last 4 years. Math tests, spelling tests, science tests. And for each one, she had prepared herself, learned what was expected of her, steeled herself. Steeled, it means like hardened herself, like she never gave up, like she got to business. Taking the test and somehow passed. She thought of the long evening she had spent at the kitchen table after the dinner dishes had been cleared away when she and her mother had used their battered English Lao dictionary to look up virtually every single word in her textbooks and carefully written the Lao equivalent above the English word so that there were faint, spidery pencil marks filling up all the spaces between the lines of her textbook. All those tests behind her, and now she had failed. Failed the one test that might have enabled her to help her parents get to work more easily, save them some money, and earn her some status among her classmates. David's face appeared at the window. How'd it go? He asked, with his usual cheerful grin. Sang suppressed an urge to pass her hand over his mouth and wipe the grin off. Not so good, she said. She started to explain, then gave it up. It wasn't worth the effort. And besides, he didn't really care anyway. He was holding the car door open for her and seemed a little impatient for her to get out. Sang squirmed out of the seat, then remembered the $20 bill her mom had given her. Thanks, she murmured awkwardly as she got out of the car. It was nice of you to come here and letting me use your car. Don't mention it, he said, sliding into the driver's seat already and pushing it back several inches. Like, so little inference there. Like, he's not waiting around to chit chat. Like, he's ready to go. Would you, I mean, if you would like, I could buy Sang faltered as she saw that David wasn't even listening to her. His attention had been distracted by someone waving to him from across the street. He was waving back and smiling. Sang followed the direction of his glance and saw a tall girl, tight jeans and a flannel shirt, standing just under the M archway. Someone blonde and vivacious, her dimpled smile revealing two rows of dazzling white, regimentally straight teeth. Definitely a cheerleader, Sang decided. Hold on, I'll be right with you. David was calling over to her. Abruptly, he pulled the car door shut, flashed Sang a perfunctory smile. Perfunctory? Actually, thought this word was so hard that maybe. Put it right down there. Perfunctory? Yeah, it just means given with the least amount of effort. He smiled, but I mean, obviously, his attention is probably on the blonde cheerleader, I guess, and the way she's dressed. Poor Sang, right? Adding insult to injury. She likes David. Maybe David's just being nice, doing what his mom said. He's a senior. She's a sophomore, right? I think. So obviously she's younger. Maybe, I don't know. It's too bad. She had that $20 for Big Macs. It's not going to happen. And actually, it gets worse. Yeah, I don't want to say too much, but yeah, the story, there's some things about Sang's, we'll get to it, right? Yeah, it's just, and I'm going to try to stop on a cliffhanger, hopefully. Hopefully you like this story. Hopefully you're, oh, I don't care. Hopefully you're not like, oh, I'm so bored. I like this story, but again, I'm an old man, and maybe that's in your type of story. I hope it is. All right, hang on, I'll be right with you. David was calling over to perfunctory. That's where we ended. Smile and started to drive off. Better luck next time, he said. I don't think he's being mean there. It's just like, I don't really think he cares. At least he said that, though. He didn't have to. He said as his car pulled away, leaving her standing in the middle of the road. So don't forget, she's in the middle of the road. She's not going to get hit or anything, but she's just standing in the middle of the road. Sang watched him make a fluid U-turn. All right. What do you think? How about that? Why do you think the author chose those words? Fluid U-turn. Pause. We're back. Hopefully somebody said to show, like, we talked about this one other time, juxtaposition. So authors do this sometimes, putting opposites side by side so their differences come out even more. She just did a horrible job driving, right? Stopping when she shouldn't and not stopping when she should. So David, like, fluid, it means like just effortlessly, like water flowing. It's very smooth. So he did a U-turn just to show like what a big difference there is between David and Sang, I think. Sad, but I think it's a good choice the author used there. And pulled up right next to the tall blonde girl, who swung herself gracefully into the seat next to David. For a moment, they sat there laughing and talking in the car, so carefree, so casual, so American. They reminded Sang of Ken and Barbie dolls that she had stared at with such curiosity and longing when she first arrived in the country. But it wasn't even longing or envy that she felt now, Sang realized. This girl could have been David's twin sister, and Sang would have still felt that stab of pain. This recognition that they belonged and she didn't. Another car drove slowly past her. And she caught a glimpse of a reflection on its window. Remember, she's still in the middle of the road, by the way. Her arms were hanging limply by her sides and she looked short and frumpy. Her hair was disheveled. Great word right there, disheveled. It's a very fancy way to say messed up. And her clothes seemed drab and old-fashioned, exactly as if they had come out of a rummage sale. She looked wrong, totally out of place. And remember, they did come out of a rummage sale. David's mom helped her pick those clothes out. Hey, move it. You're blocking traffic. A car had pulled up alongside of her. And in the front passenger seat sat the test instructor, scowling at her, his thick lips taut with irritation. taut. It's just another word for tight. Sang stood rooted to the spot. She stared at him, stared at those thick lips beneath that bushy mustache, and suddenly she was jolted back to another time, another place, another voice. It had all been so long ago and so far away, yet now she still found herself immobilized by the immediacy of the past. Immobilized, she can't move. Immediacy, it's so close, but it's the past. Once, shortly after she had arrived in America, when she had been watching an absorbing ballet program on the PBS channel at Mrs. Lambert's house, someone had switched the channels with a remote control, and it seemed as if the gracefully dying Giselle and Swan Lake, I've never seen Swan Lake, shame on me maybe, but it does seem, I know that Swan Lake, well, does anybody, if anybody knows more than me, please raise your hand. I'd love to hear it. As far as I know, Swan Lake is a ballet dancing, stuff like that. I didn't know there's a Giselle in there, but she's dying. But I think they use it gracefully, you know, maybe in some sort of dance movement or something. I'm not sure. But there's going to be something that's quite jarring here next. Had suddenly been riddled with bullets from a screeching getaway car. So when the channel changed, like this gracefully dying channel change, you got like, I don't know what's going on there, but seems like a gunfight or something like that. So jarring had it been that Sang felt as if an electric shock had charged through her, jolting her from one reality into the other. All right. And we're going to find out in just a minute why that was so jarring. It was like that now, as if someone had switched channels in her life. She was no longer standing on a quiet street in downtown Danby, but was in the midst of a jostling crowd of tired, dusty people under a blazing sun. And it was not the balding driving instructor yelling at her, but a thick-lipped man in a khaki uniform waving them imperiously, the submachine gun. Okay, so this actually happened in Sang's life, right? So, I mean, this sounds like PTSD from what she went through. If you remember, we talked about with Lao, Vietnam War. Yeah, Lao is not Vietnam, but because of the fighting, the U.S. military attacked parts of Lao without permission, unannounced, no declaration of war, whatever. So the citizens of Lao, some of them could have been deeply affected. Khaki uniform, probably some kind of soldier. Maybe a U.S. soldier, maybe a Vietnamese soldier, maybe a Lao soldier. I looked up Danby, by the way, just because I'm like wondering, like, where does this take place? We know they have winters. We know that Minnesota, Wisconsin have a high concentration of Lao immigrants. But the Danby that I looked up, it was only two states that had a cities over 1,000. So Danby, New York had like a population of 3,000 something. Vermont had 1,000 something. So it could be New York. I'm just going with the, you know, percentages. Like it's more likely that it's New York. Probably not Vermont. Could be though. Both have winters. And imperiously, it's describing someone who's in charge, but like they're abusing their power. You know, maybe like a soldier just like, Who knows what? I mean, obviously there's some kind of danger maybe, and they're trying to get them out of there or whatever. Sang's just a little kid, but some of these emotions are coming back to her. And I'm sure, you know, a lot of us have been, you know, taken off like, whoa, you know, you just, maybe you were daydreaming or something like that and you snapped too. Well, to be honest, like in my life, I've never had anything like I would consider PTSD, you know, no abuse, things like that. But obviously, if you have some of those emotional things in your background, and then maybe you're caught off guard, it can be even more jarring than somebody like me who's never really had any major trauma. So I can imagine Sang, who will learn more about how she transferred from Lao to the United States. And we heard a little bit about the test. I mean, it's obviously it's not easy for her. But also add in a war, then it's that much more difficult. So hopefully that you enjoy this story. We're going to learn a little bit more about Sang's background in Lao. We're gonna get a year. It's right there, 1978. So that definitely puts it within the scope of the Vietnam War. Vietnam War ends officially in early 1975. So it's in that general area. So, and we know even in 2022, Laos is just still riddled with bombs, most bombed country per capita. So lasting effects. All right, hope you enjoy it. A little time to work in class. Maybe that quiz from Friday if you didn't finish it. And then a little Frank.